Okay, now your Psalm book 379.
379.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Brethren, see poor sinners round you slumbering on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving. Can you bear to let them go? See our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister aided him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? Tell them all about the Savior. Tell them how he will be found. Sisters, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
And that's going to happen. That's our destiny. 182. What a friend we have in Jesus. You can always count on him, can't you? His friend sticks closer than anybody else.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friend despise, forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee, thou wilt find a solace there.
And that song also is true. Very much so. Okay, if you have your outlines, y'all can be seated. And this time, a miracle's taking place. I get to preach in one spot. You don't have to move over about a dozen different scriptures. Can anybody say praise the Lord? So it'll be Psalms 116. Now last Sunday, we looked at how to learn to take what God gives to you, to receive from the Lord. And I used one of the verses in this psalm to introduce that sermon to you last Sunday. And it was, I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. What can we give, or what can we render unto the Lord for all of his benefits toward us? Well, now it's, we've taken from the Lord, we've received from the Lord. Now it's our turn to give to the Lord, to give him thanks. So when I studied this particular psalm, I found seven I wills. These were choices that he made in his worship of God and his thankfulness to the Lord and learning to relate to the Lord in his everyday life. And this is what we have to do. So Father, we ask that you take this word now. It's anointed. So Father, we pray you open up the ears of our hearts to receive the anointed word, that it be engrafted to our soul and bring about the change that you want of us, that we will learn to receive from you and give back to you what you give to us. But always, 24/7, we learn your presence. We learn to trust you. We learn to walk with you. And help us, Lord, to choose you in every way, in everything. And we thank you for the privilege of it because of being your children. And we ask it in Jesus' precious name, and everybody said,
amen.
Amen. All right. The first verse in Psalm 116, and this psalmist is really showing a grateful heart to the Lord. He's really blessing the Lord and giving thanks to the Lord. He said, I love the Lord. Why? Because he has heard my voice and my supplications. God listens to our prayers. He listens to us even when we're not praying. He knows what's going on with our conversation with people. So he's listening all the time. But he's learned to love the Lord because the Lord has responded to him. And God responds to us because he loves us. He proved it at the cross. Because he has inclined his ear unto me, therefore, now here's one of the I wills, the choices of everyday life. I will call upon the name of the Lord as long as I live. That is a privilege, and it's a choice, and it's something we ought to do all the time. Is there anything too hard for God to handle? Does he want us to talk to him all the time about everything? Yes, he does. He absolutely does. He's building a relationship with us through his son. We have to learn to walk with him, trust him, and love him back. And give to him what he wants. And he wants your all. It's best for us that we benefit from the Lord by surrendering our whole entire self to him. He says, the sorrows, verse 3, the sorrows of death compass me and the pains of Sheol, King James uses the word hell, got a hold of me. So what was going on there? The devil was after him. The demons were tormenting him. They were being hostile. They were attacking. And I found out when you follow the Lord, the enemy comes after you. He's relentless. He wants you to quit what you're doing. And he says, but because I found trouble and sorrow in this, I call, verse 4 shows you the result of what happened when he was attacked by the enemy, when the kingdom of darkness came upon him. He went to the Lord. He knew where to go. I called upon the name of the Lord. Now, what is the name of the Lord? Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we call upon him. Amen. I call upon the name of the Lord. I beseech thee, Lord, deliver my soul. Now, why did he say that? The word deliver there is the same word for redemption and salvation. And it's an interesting word because it means to be rescued. And there's times in our lives when we go through things, we need the Lord to rescue us. Does he do it? Yes, he does. He's always faithful to us. Now, he delivered my soul. What was going on in his soul? Well, there's the mind, your emotions, and the will, the power to choose. And of course, in the mind, you've got your thoughts, you've got your past that's there, your presence that's there, and the things you're dealing with, your thinking. And so our thought life needs to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. But many times we give in to the thoughts of the flesh and the world and the devil, and it winds up defeating us. So we need the Lord to preserve us in every way in our soul. The mind, your emotions, your feelings, and your will, the power to choose. This man was choosing seven times, I will call upon the Lord. I will choose to worship God no matter what I'm going through. This is what he chose to do. And that's what we should be doing also. So then he recognizes one of the Lord's attributes in verse 5. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. God always does things right. Let me tell you something about his grace. His grace comes to you at the time you need it. Hebrews 4:16 proves that. It's well-timed grace at the moment you need it. And all you got to do is reach out and take it and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for being there for me. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. Now, what is mercy? Mercy is pardon and it's forgiveness. It's saying, I will count you guiltless. I will say to you, I forgive you, and I'm not going to hold it against you. And that's what the cross did. The cross is mercy that God gives to us. And that's something else that's well-timed, given to us at the very time that we need it. There's many times that I say, Lord, today I need mercy. Or today I name a person. I say, today they need your mercy. They need your love. They need your kindness. They need your forgiveness. They need your pardon. And I call upon the Lord for my family and friends and church people. Because I want to see God's mercy manifested. That's what the cross is all about. And then he said, the Lord preserves the simple. I'm sure glad of that because I'm about as simple as you can get. And that word preserve has to do with his keeping power. Once you become born again, you're a child forever. You're never going to lose your salvation because God preserves us. He keeps us. What he rebirths, he doesn't unbirth. John 3 talks about that. And praise God that when we get into sin, when we get sometimes we don't walk with him, he doesn't cast us away. He pulls us back into the fold. He pulls us back into fellowship with the power of the Holy Spirit's conviction that moves upon us, upon his children. So the Lord preserves the simple. I was brought low and he helped me. There's times in our lives when we get down, we go through things, despair and depression, and sometimes we feel like there's no hope. And we realize the Holy Spirit says, wait a minute, you're leaving God out. Where's Jesus in all your thinking? So we have to bring the Lord back into our thinking, back into our speaking, back into our heart, and realize He's all we need. And because He's all we have, He's always there. He said, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. Now, in verse 7, he's got a term here that was interesting when I studied this word, rest. Return unto thy rest, O my soul. So his soul was in torment. His mind, emotions, and will, and conscience was all under attack. But he said, I return to the rest. Now, what is the word rest? It actually means a place that is completely still. Where is that at? It's in the presence of God. It's in His presence. And we call upon Him because His presence is always here. And He gives us His rest. It's like what Jesus said in Matthew 11, if you'll come to me, I'll give you rest. My yoke is easy. Get yoked up with Jesus, not your burdens and stuff you're going through. Stay yoked up with Jesus. He says, I'll give you my rest. It's heavenly rest. It's a place of quietness that nobody can give you but Jesus. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with me. And that word means overflowing with Him and His attributes that He gives to us because we belong to Him. Now, verse 8, for thou hast delivered my soul from death and mine eyes from tears and my feet from falling. And there's many times that many people wanted to slay David because he was following the Lord. And of course, God was testing him, but the devil was too. Thank God that he went to the Lord when he felt like he was not going to make it. Sometimes in life we have dark moments and we feel like we're not going to make it. If we go to the Lord, He shows you that He's there and you will make it. He holds your future in His hands. And remember this, that future is eternal. It's eternal. And the word delivered is that same word again, rescue. It has to do with redemption and salvation. And then he says, I will. See in verse 9, I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. What was he saying there? He says, I know that when I die, I'm going to be eternally with God. I'm going to walk in that place called heaven. Forever. That's our destiny. That's our home. So he kept his faith in the right place, God in heaven. I believe, verse 10, I believe and therefore I have spoken. I was greatly afflicted. And he went through a lot of trials and testings. And a lot of times that he felt like he wasn't going to make it. And he would run to the Lord and the Lord would show him, I will hold you up. God delivers on His promises. We take Him at His word, and He fulfills that word in our lives. And we go through all kinds of afflictions, body, soul, and spirit. Spiritual afflictions and soulish afflictions, body afflictions. All through life, the good, bad, and the ugly, mankind goes through afflictions. And then in verse 11 he says, I said in my haste, all men are liars. Every one of us has lied. Adam and Eve was the first liar. And they tried to lie to God in the Garden of Eden. And the Lord said, I already know what you've done. I already know everything about it. So you might as well trust me. Come to me and trust me. And we're born lying. One of the first things we do when we grow up, because we don't want to get in trouble with our parents, is we'll lie to them because we don't want to get in trouble. We don't want to be found out. Well, God knows everything. It's already been found out. And you know what you find out about a lie? When you lie, you got to tell another lie to cover up the first one. Then you got to tell a third lie to cover up the second one and the first one. So, yeah. So where are you going with that? You're going to build from a molehill to a mountain. Just tell the truth. We're supposed to be people of truth. Speak the truth, live the truth, and tell the truth. Amen? Now, I love these two verses right here. They really get me every time I read them, because it's very important in our life as a Christian. What can I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits towards me? How in the world can I ever pay the Lord back? Well, the Bible says that we need to learn to praise him, to give him thanks in everything, because that's God's will for us. Praise him for who he is and how who he is has affected your life. Well, it's affected our life tremendously because we came to the cross, received Christ as our Savior, and we get the benefit of eternal salvation. We get the benefit of heaven, and we get the benefit of God's benefits here on earth. If we trust him and go to him and surrender to him, what can I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits towards me? Loving, serving, obeying, be a witness for him, win people to Christ, hand out tracts, Bibles to people, give the living word to people out here in the world. You know what? The angels rejoice every time a person gets born again. There's a big time of worship goes on every time somebody gets saved. And then he said this in verse 13, another I will take the cup of salvation. Now, why did he use the word cup? It's like this, I'm going to take salvation, and let me tell you what the word salvation means. In the Hebrew, it means Yeshua. You know what that is in English? Jesus. So Jesus means salvation. Jesus means Savior. It means to be saved. But here's something else that it means in the Hebrew and the Greek. The Greek is soteria. It also means safety, saved, but it also says soundness, heavenly soundness. You can't get no soundness on this earth. You can get that from heaven. Heaven in your soul is Jesus. So it has to do with being eternally secure, eternally safe. And deliverance is another word that comes out of that. Deliverance, rescuing us. That's what Jesus did when he came to this world, died on the cross. He rescued the sinners. There's a song about rescue the perishing. We were one of those at one time. Amen? Has to do with regeneration, being born again. God came to this world through his son and he rescued the sinners, the slaves to sin. That was us. Romans 10:13 supports that, to call upon the name of the Lord, and he would save you. Didn't say he might, he said, I will save you. I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, the Anointed One. Now here's something else sometimes we do, and we fall back on this one. I will pay my vows unto the Lord. What is a vow? It's a promise. You ever made a promise to God and not keep it? I know when I was a kid growing up, us kids was always telling one another, you know, and even our parents at the time, I promised to God, and lying through our teeth. But everybody's done it. Well, I think we need to take it more serious, because I know children, when you promise them something and you don't keep it, they never forget it. I wonder how God feels about it when we give him a promise. He never forgets it. And what does he think about it when we don't keep the promise? I will pay my vows, my promises unto the Lord now in the presence of all of his people. So that's in the place of worship, whoever God's people are out in the neighborhood, and we make promises, and we say, okay, we get God's name involved in it. Now we've included him in whatever we're doing. Now here's something that is always precious to us. every time we lose a friend, a church member, or a loved one, here's what God says in verse 15. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Now, I looked that word up, precious. What does that mean? That when we die before the Lord, he says, it's precious in my sight. He says, it's highly to be praised for me. He doesn't take it lightly. It's very heavenly, of heavenly importance to him. A lot of times it may not mean anything to anybody else, but let me tell you something, it's of high value to God because he owns us, lock, stock, and barrel. And the beautiful thing about it is he never loses us in any way. When we die physically, we're in the presence of the Lord. The day will come when the body will also be in the presence of the Lord because it's sanctified even now. According to Romans 8, there's a verse there that talks about that. So the believer, his body, his soul, and his spirit will all be in heaven one day, completely intact. I mean, total heavenly. It's hard to describe because it's not anything of this earth. Everything is eternally made, your body, soul, and spirit. I mean, it's hard to describe. It's just, it's heaven. And that's where we're headed. But I want you to know that it's precious to the Lord. Verse 16, O Lord, truly I am thy servant. Can we say that about ourselves today? Are you his servant? Are you serving him? Are you worshiping him? Are you witnessing for him out here in this world? Are you letting other people know that you're a servant of the Lord? Are you available to people to help them spiritually with the Lord in the scriptures? We should be. The Bible says to be ready in season and out of season. There's always going to be somebody the Lord's going to have you be the person that he's going to minister through to somebody else. O Lord, truly I am thy servant. I am thy servant and the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bond. What's he talking about there? He's talking about the chains. Being a prisoner to some sin or some habit that you haven't been able to get rid of. The chains that bind us, your past, the world, the devil, and that old sinful nature that always wants to bind you up. What did he say about this? God has loosed those bonds, those chains from him. To do what? To serve him. How can you serve the Lord if you're all bound up and chained up with your past and everything else going on in your life, your circumstances? You can't. It's difficult to serve the Lord when you're bound up. So we have to stay surrendered and filled with his spirit, walking with him, walking in the spirit, says in Galatians 5. Now, that shows you why he could do what verse 17 is talking about. Because the Lord has set him free, look what happened. I will offer. Now, that word in the Hebrew has to do with worship. I will offer our worship with my life to thee, the sacrifice of thanksgiving. A sacrifice, a sacrificial lamb or whatever that was put on the altar before the Lord is an act of worship, the Old Testament. And Jesus did that one time for us and for God. He was the Lamb of God that was slain on the altar of the cross one time for God. He could accept us. Anybody that comes to Christ, that sacrifice takes place and we receive salvation, rescue, eternal safety. I will offer thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving. There's times in our lives when we don't feel like offering a sacrifice of thanksgiving because we're going through something hard. We're going through something dreadful. We're going through a black moment of life. And I want you to know, if you learn to praise him and thank him no matter what, he will be in the midst of that praise. It says, in fact, I've got it right here on the pulpit in Psalm 50:23. It says, whosoever offers praise glorifies me, says God. To him that orders his conversation, his way, his life aright, will I show my salvation. That's a promise. But we have to learn to praise God and thank God in the midst of the hardest times of life. And he's in it with you. He will see you through. I will offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving. I will call upon the name of the Lord. Now, in the Old Testament, there were a lot of Old Testament names, like Jehovah Jireh, the God will be the provider. Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace. There's so many different names that the Lord has in the Old Testament. And guess what? They mean eternally something to us. And they did to the Jew as well. So the name of the Lord, and for us, it's Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ. I will pay, verse 18, I will pay my vows, my promises unto the Lord now in the presence of all of his people. So twice he's admitted that to the Lord. You know, one of the things that people don't understand that call themselves Christians, when we are together in a local church worshiping the Lord Jesus, it does something to our soul, to our spirit, to be together with Christ, with God's people. And when we choose not to come together, now I'm not talking about people who are sick or in the hospital, or they're traveling, or, you know, there's a lot of different things that why people can't be in a church. But when you can be in the church building with God's people, the Bible says in Hebrews 10:25, to forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. There's a reason for that command, and the benefit is given to us. But it also goes back to the Lord in the act of worship, that we came by faith to be with God's people, to be with the Lord and worship him and leave this place knowing it was good to be with the Lord and God's people. So we have to get into a spiritual habit of saying, yes, I want to be with God's people. This is what he was doing, and he was making a promise. It's something I believe us modern day Christians ought to do. Give promises to the Lord that I will be with your people when we meet together. Now, verse 19, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of thee, O Jerusalem, praise ye the Lord. You know what he's talking about there? The celebration of worship to God. And we're doing it together. Amen? Down at the bottom of your bulletin there, I close this lesson out by saying this. Our daily life needs to have these seven I wills, just like the psalmist did. We need to make a choice. I will. And look at all that he chose to do, that because God gave him the benefits of salvation, eternal life, and all the benefits through his life. We need to give back to the Lord and say, Lord, I will be active. I will be faithful. I will serve you. I'll be your witness. I'll be in worship with your people. And we need to do that with a commitment with body, soul, and spirit, mind, emotions, will, and conscience. Again, the question, what can I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits toward me?
Myself.
Amen. Ourself. Our will. Surrender. Romans 12:1-2 talks about that. He said, I beg of you, Christians, I urge you to surrender your body, your entire life, your wills, your conscience, your spirit, everything to the Lord as an act of worship. And be not transformed by the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And that's the Word of God, the importance of the Word of God in our life. It's our guidebook. It transforms us. It helps us to walk with the Lord. It's got all the answers we'll ever need to life. It's right in His Word. And that anointed Word is there, and He gives to us the Logos. It becomes the Rhema, the spoken Word by the Spirit of God into our spirit, and it becomes eternal to us. And He speaks those words to us at the very moment we need, and that's His grace because He loves us. He gives that to us. Amen? So remember, what can I render unto the Lord? The main thing, the first thing, is to take and drink of eternal life. Take the salvation that Jesus purchased for us with His blood, and then see all the eternal benefits of that life that He gives to us. Here and now, and then when we're with Him forever. Father God, we want to thank You, Lord, for giving to us the cup of salvation, Yeshua, the Lord Jesus, delivering us, setting us free from sin in the world, rescuing us, and giving to us eternal life in heaven with You forever. Thank You, Lord, that that is eternally secure. We are eternally safe because we're in Jesus. We're in the family of God because of reborn, the new birth that You give to us, that salvation. And we praise You for it. Father, if there be anybody right here or that listen to this on the YouTube that really doesn't know Jesus, they may be a church member, but never know Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, never been really born again, I pray for a miracle in that life, that right now that person would reach out and say, I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. And Jesus, as you hear that, you respond, you give the miracle of rebirth, of bringing that person into Your heavenly family. And Father, for those that are already saved, those that have already taken the cup of salvation, just help us all to walk with You in a Spirit-filled way, controlled by Your Spirit. As even as the psalmist said, being a servant of the Lord, wanting to serve You and praise You and give You thanks all through this life. And we thank You for it and we praise You for it because we ask it in Jesus' precious and holy name. And everybody said, Amen. Amen.